Analog television. Analog television or analog television is the original television technology that uses analog signals to transmit video and audio. In an analog television broadcast, the brightness, colors and sound are represented by rapid variations of either the amplitude, frequency or phase of the signal. Analog signals vary over a continuous range of possible values, which means that electronic noise and interference becomes reproduced by the receiver. Thus with analog, a moderately weak signal becomes snowy and subject to interference. In contrast, a moderately weak digital signal and a very strong digital signal transmit equal picture quality. Analog television may be wireless or can be distributed over a cable network using cable converters. All broadcast television systems used analog signals before the arrival of digital television, DTV. Motivated by the lower bandwidth requirements of compressed digital signals, since the 2000s a digital television transition is proceeding in most countries of the world, with different deadlines for cessation of analog broadcasts. The earliest systems of analog television were mechanical television systems, which used spinning discs with patterns of holes punched into the disc to scan an image. A similar disc reconstructed the image at the receiver. Synchronization of the receiver disc rotation was handled through sync pulses broadcast with the image information. However, these mechanical systems were slow, the images were dim and flickered severely, and the image resolution varied low. Camera systems used similar spinning discs and required intensely bright illumination of the subject for the light detector to work. Analog television did not really begin as an industry until the development of the cathode ray tube, CRT, which uses a focused electron beam to trace lines across a phosphor-coated surface. The electron beam could be swept across the screen much faster than any mechanical disc system, allowing for more closely spaced scan lines and much higher image resolution. Also, far less maintenance was required of an all-electronic system compared to a spinning disc system. All electronic systems became popular with households after the Second World War. Broadcasters of analog television encode their signal using different systems. The official systems of transmission are named A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, K, K1, L, M and N. These systems determine the number of scan lines, frame rate, channel width, video bandwidth, video audio separation, and so on. The colors in those systems are encoded with one of three color coding schemes, NTSC, PAL, or CCAM, and then use RF modulation to modulate this signal onto a very high frequency, VHF, or ultra-high frequency, UHF, carrier. Each frame of a television image is composed of lines drawn on the screen. The lines are of varying brightness, the whole set of lines is drawn quickly enough that the human eye perceives it as one image. The next sequential frame is displayed, allowing the depiction of motion. The analog television signal contains timing and synchronization information, so that the receiver can reconstruct a two-dimensional moving image from a one-dimensional time-varying signal. The first commercial television systems were black and white. The beginning of color television was in the 1950s. A practical television system needs to take luminance, prominence, in a color system, synchronization, horizontal and vertical, and audio signals, and broadcast them over a radio transmission. The transmission system must include a means of television channel selection. Analog broadcast television systems come in a variety of frame rates and resolutions. Further differences exist in the frequency and modulation of the audio carrier. The monochrome combinations still existing in the 1950s are standardized by the International Telecommunication Union, ITU, as capital letters A through N. When color television was introduced, the hue and saturation information was added to the monochrome signals in a way that black and white televisions ignore. In this way, backwards compatibility was achieved. That concept is true for all analog television standards. There were three standards for the way the additional color information can be encoded and transmitted. The first was the American NTSC, National Television Systems Committee, Color Television System. The European/Australian PAL, Phase Alternation Line Rate, and the French former Soviet Union CCAM, Sequential Color Avec Mémoire, standard were developed later in attempt to cure certain defects of the NTSC system. PAL's color encoding is similar to the NTSC system's. CCAM, though, uses a different modulation approach than PAL or NTSC. In principle, all three color encoding systems can be combined with any scan line/frame rate combination. Therefore, in order to describe a given signal completely, it's necessary to quote the color system and the broadcast standard as a capital letter. For example, the United States, Canada, Mexico and South Korea use NTSCM, many of these transitioned or transitioning to digital. Japan uses NTSCJ, discontinued in 2012, when Japan transitioned to digital, ISDB, the UK uses PALI, discontinued in 2012, when UK transitioned to digital, DBBT, France uses CKML, discontinued in 2011, when France transitioned to digital, DBBT, much of Western Europe and Australia use PAL-B/G, many of these transition or transitioning to DBBT as digital television standards, most of Eastern Europe uses CKMD/K or PAL-D/K and so on. However, not all of these possible combinations actually exist. NTSC is currently only used with System M, even though there were experiments with NTSC A405 line, in the UK and NTSC N625 line, in part of South America. PAL is used with a variety of 625 line standards, B, G, D, K, I, N, but also with the North American 525 line standard, accordingly named PAL-M. Likewise, CKM is used with a variety of 625 line standards. For this reason, many people refer to any 625-25 type signal as PAL and to any 525-30 signal as NTSC, even when referring to digital signals, for example, on DVD video, which does not contain any analog color encoding, and thus no PAL or NTSC signals at all. Even though this usage is common, it is misleading, as that is not the original meaning of the terms PAL/CKM/NTSC. Although a number of different broadcast television systems were in use worldwide, the same principles of operation apply. In many countries, over-the-air broadcast television of analog audio and analog video signals has been discontinued, to allow the reuse of the television broadcast radio spectrum for other services such as datacasting and subchannels. A cathode ray tube, CRT, television displays an image by scanning a beam of electrons across the screen in a pattern of horizontal lines known as a raster dot. At the end of each line, the beam returns to the start of the next line. The end of the last line is a link that returns to the top of the screen. As it passes each point, the intensity of the beam is varied, varying the luminance of that point. A color television system is identical except that an additional signal known as chrominance controls the color of the spot. Raster scanning is shown in a slightly simplified form below. When analog television was developed, no affordable technology for storing any video signals existed. The luminance signal has to be generated and transmitted at the same time at which it is displayed on the CRT. It is therefore essential to keep the raster scanning in the camera, or other device for producing the signal in exact synchronization with the scanning in the television. The physics of the CRT require that a finite time interval be allowed for the spot to move back to the start of the next line, horizontal retrace, or the start off the screen, vertical retrace. The timing of the luminance signal must allow for this. The human eye has a characteristic called phi phenomenon. Quickly displaying successive scan images will allow the apparent illusion of smooth motion. Flickering of the image can be partially solved using a long persistence phosphor coating on the CRT, so that successive images fade slowly. However, slow phosphor has the negative side effect of causing image smearing and blurring when there is a large amount of rapid on-screen motion occurring. The maximum frame rate depends on the bandwidth of the electronics and the transmission system, and the number of horizontal scan lines in the image. A frame rate of 25 or 30 Hz is a satisfactory compromise, while the process of interlacing two video fields of the picture per frame is used to build the image. This process doubles the apparent number of video frames per second and further reduces flicker and other defects in transmission. Plasma screens and LCD screens have been used in analog television sets. These types of display screens use lower voltages than older CRT displays. Many dual-system television receivers, equipped to receive both analog transmissions and digital transmissions, have analog tuner receiving capability and must use a television antenna. The television system for each country will specify a number of television channels within the UHF or VHF frequency ranges. A channel actually consists of two signals. The picture information is transmitted using amplitude modulation on one frequency, and the sound is transmitted with frequency modulation at a frequency at a fixed offset, typically 4.5 to 6 MHz, from the picture signal. The channel frequencies chosen represent a compromise between allowing enough bandwidth for video, and hence satisfactory picture resolution, and allowing enough channels to be packed into the available frequency band. In practice, a technique called vestigial sideband is used to reduce the channel spacing, which would be nearly twice the video bandwidth if pure AM was used. Signal reception is invariably done via a superheterodyne receiver. The first stage is a tuner which selects a television channel and frequency shifts it to a fixed intermediate frequency, IF. The signal amplifier performs amplification to the IF stages from the microvolt range to fractions of a volt. At this point, the IF signal consists of a video carrier signal at one frequency and the sound carrier at a fixed offset. A demodulator recovers the video signal. Also at the output of the same demodulator is a new frequency modulated sound carrier at the offset frequency. In some sets made before 1948, this was filtered out, and the sound IF of about 22 MHz was sent to an FM demodulator to recover the basic sound signal. In newer sets, this new carrier at the offset frequency was allowed to remain as intercarrier sound, and it was sent to an FM demodulator to recover the basic sound signal. One particular advantage of intercarrier sound is that when the front panel fine-tuning knob is adjusted, the sound carrier frequency does not change with the tuning, but stays at the above-mentioned offset frequency. Consequently, it is easier to tune the picture without losing the sound. So the FM sound carrier is then demodulated, amplified, and used to drive a loudspeaker. Until the advent of the NICM and MTS systems, television sound transmissions were invariably monophonic. The video carrier is demodulated to give a composite video signal. This contains luminance, chrominance and synchronization signals. This is identical to the video signal format used by analog video devices such as VCRs or CCTV cameras. Note that the RF signal modulation is inverted compared to the conventional AM. The minimum video signal level corresponds to maximum carrier amplitude, and vice versa. To ensure good linearity, fidelity, consistent with affordable manufacturing costs of transmitters and receivers, the video carrier is never shut off altogether. When intercarrier sound was invented later in 1948, not completely shutting off the carrier had the side effect of allowing intercarrier sound to be economically implemented. Each line of the displayed image is transmitted using a signal as shown above. The same basic format, with minor differences mainly related to timing and the encoding of color, is used for PAL, NTSC and CCAM television systems. A monochrome signal is identical to a color one, with the exception that the element shown in color in the diagram, the color burst, and the chrominance signal, are not present. The front porch is a brief, about 1.5 microsecond, period inserted between the end of each transmitted line of picture and the leading edge of the next linesync pulse. Its purpose was to allow voltage levels to stabilize in older televisions, preventing interference between picture lines. The front porch is the first component of the horizontal blanking interval, which also contains the horizontal sync pulse and the back porch. The back porch is the portion of each scan line between the end, rising edge, of the horizontal sync pulse and the start of active video. It is used to restore the black level, 300 millivolts, reference in analog video. In signal processing terms, it compensates for the fall time and settling time following sync pulse. In color television systems such as PAL and NTSC, this period also includes the color burst signal. In the CCAM system, it contains the reference subcarrier for each consecutive color difference signal in order to set the zero color reference. In some professional systems, particularly satellite links between locations, the audio is embedded within the back porch of the video signal, to save the cost of renting a second channel. The luminance component of a composite video signal varies between 0V and approximately 0.7V above the black level. In the NTSC system, there is a blanking signal level used during the front porch and back porch, and a black signal level 75 millivolts above it. In PAL and SECAM, these are identical. In a monochrome receiver, the luminance signal is amplified to drive the control grid in the electron gun of the CRT. This changes the intensity of the electron beam and therefore the brightness of the spot being scanned. Brightness and contrast controls determine the DC shift and amplification, respectively. A color signal conveys picture information for each of the red, green, and blue components of an image. See the article on color space for more information. However, these are not simply transmitted as three separate signals, because such a signal would not be compatible with monochrome receivers, an important consideration when color broadcasting was first introduced. It would also occupy 3 times the bandwidth of existing television, requiring a decrease in the number of television channels available. Furthermore, typical problems with signal transmission, such as differing received signal levels between different colors, would produce unpleasant side effects. Instead, the RGB signals are converted into UV form, where the Y signal represents the lightness and darkness, luminance, of the colors in the image. Because the rendering of colors in this way is the goal of both black and white, monochrome, film and black and white, monochrome, television systems, the Y signal is ideal for transmission as the luminance signal. This ensures the monochrome receiver will display a correct picture in black and white, where a given color is reproduced by a shade of gray that correctly reflects how light or dark the original color is. The U and V signals are color difference signals. The U signal is the difference between the B signal and the Y signal, also known as B-Y, VY, and the V signal is the difference between the R signal and the Y signal, also known as R-Y, RY. The U signal then represents how purplish-blue or its complementary color yellowish-green the color is, and the V signal how purplish-red or its complementary greenish-cyan it is. The advantage of this scheme is that the U and V signals are zero when the picture has no color content. Since the human eye is more sensitive to errors in luminance than in color, the U and V signals can be transmitted in a relatively lossy, specifically, bandwidth-limited, way with acceptable results. In the receiver, a single V modulator can extract an additive combination of U plus V. An example is the X demodulator used in the XC demodulation system. In that same system, a second demodulator, the Z demodulator, also extracts an additive combination of U plus V, but in a different ratio. The X and Z color difference signals are further matrixed into 3 color difference signals, RY, VY, and GY. The combinations of usually 2, but sometimes 3 demodulators were. In the end, further matrixing of the above color difference signals C3F yielded the 3 color difference signals, RY, BY, and GY. The R, G, B signals in the receiver needed for the display device, CRT, plasma display or LCD display, are electronically derived by matrixing as follows. R is the additive combination of RY with Y, G is the additive combination of GY with Y, and B is the additive combination of BY with Y. All of this is accomplished electronically. It can be seen that in the combining process, the low resolution portion of the Y signals cancel out, leaving R, G, and B signals able to render a low resolution image in full color. However, the higher resolution portions of the Y signals do not cancel out, and so are equally present in R, G, and B, producing the higher definition, higher resolution, image detail in monochrome, although it appears to the human eye as a full color and full resolution picture. In the NTSC and PAL color systems, U and V are transmitted by using quadrature amplitude modulation of a subcarrier. This kind of modulation applies 2 independent signals to 1 subcarrier, with the idea that both signals will be recovered independently at the receive end. Before transmission, the subcarrier itself is removed from the active, visible portion of the video, and moved, in the form of a burst, to the horizontal blanking portion, which is not directly visible on screen. More about the burst below. For NTSC, the subcarrier is a 3.58 MHz sine wave. For the PAL system it is a 4.43 MHz sine wave. After the above-mentioned quadrature amplitude modulation off the subcarrier, subcarrier sidebands are produced, and the subcarrier itself is filtered out of the visible portion of the video, since it is the subcarrier sidebands that carry all of the U and V information, and the subcarrier itself carries no information. The resulting subcarrier sidebands is also known as chroma or chrominance. Physically, this chrominance signal is a 3.58 MHz NTSC, or 4.43 MHz PAL, sine wave which, in response to changing U and V values, changes phase as compared to the subcarrier, and also changes amplitude. As it turns out, the chroma amplitude, when considered together with the Y signal, represents the approximate saturation of a color, and the chroma phase against the subcarrier as reference, approximately represents the hue of the color. For particular test colors found in the test color bar pattern, exact amplitudes and phases are sometimes defined for test and troubleshooting purposes only. Although, in response to changing U and V values, the chroma sine wave changes phase with respect to the subcarrier, it's not correct to say that the subcarrier is simply phase modulated. That is because a single sine wave you test signal with COM produces only one pair of sidebands, whereas real phase modulation under the same test conditions would produce multiple sets of sidebands occupying more frequency spectrum. In NTSC, the chrominance sine wave has the same average frequency as the subcarrier frequency. But a spectrum analyzer instrument shows that, for transmitted chrominance, the frequency component at the subcarrier frequency is actually zero energy, verifying that the subcarrier was indeed removed before transmission. These sideband frequencies are within the luminance signal band, which is why they are called subcarrier sidebands instead of simply carrier sidebands. Their exact frequencies were chosen such that, for NTSC, they are midway between two harmonics of the frame repetition rate, thus ensuring that the majority of the power of the luminance signal does not overlap with the power of the chrominance signal. In the British PAL, D, system, the actual chrominance center frequency, with equal lower and upper sidebands, is 4.43361875 MHz, a direct multiple of the scan rate frequency. This frequency was chosen to minimize the chrominance beat interference pattern that would be visible in areas of high color saturation in the transmitted picture. At certain times, the chrominance signal represents only the U signal, and 70 nanoseconds, NTSC, later, the chrominance signal represents only the V signal. This is the nature of the quadrature amplitude modulation process that created the chrominance signal, about 70 nanoseconds later still, U, and another 70 nanoseconds, V. So to extract U, a synchronous demodulator is utilized, which uses the subcarrier to briefly gate, sample, the chroma every 280 nanoseconds, so that the output is only a train of discrete pulses, each having an amplitude that is the same as the original U signal at the corresponding time. In effect, these pulses are discrete time analog samples of the U signal. The pulses are then low-pass filtered so that the original analog continuous time U signal is recovered. For V, a 90-degree shifted subcarrier briefly gates the chroma signal every 280 nanoseconds, and the rest of the process is identical to that used for the U signal. Gating at any other time than those times mentioned above will yield an additive mixture of any two of U, V, U, or V. One of these off-axis, that is, off the U and V axis, gating methods is called IQ demodulation. Another much more popular off-axis scheme was the X/Z modulation system. Further matrixing recovered the original U and V signals. This scheme was actually the most popular demodulator scheme throughout the 60s. The above process uses the subcarrier. But as previously mentioned, it was deleted before transmission, and only the chroma is transmitted. Therefore, the receiver must reconstitute the subcarrier. For this purpose, a short burst of subcarrier, known as the color burst, is transmitted during the backborge, retrace blanking period, of each scan line. A subcarrier oscillator in the receiver locks onto this signal, see phase locked loop, to achieve a phase reference, resulting in the oscillator producing the reconstituted subcarrier. NTSC uses this process unmodified. Unfortunately, this often results in poor color reproduction due to phase errors in the received signal, caused sometimes by multipath, but mostly by poor implementation at the studio end. With the advent of solid-state receivers, cable TV, and digital studio equipment for conversion to an over-the-air analog signal, these NTSC problems have been largely fixed, leaving operator error at the studio end as the sole color rendition weakness of the NTSC system. In any case, the PAL-D delay system mostly corrects these kind of errors by reversing the phase of the signal on each successive line, and the averaging the results over pairs of lines. This process is achieved by the use of a 1H, where H equals horizontal scan frequency, duration delay line. A typical circuit used with this device converts the low-frequency color signal to ultrasound and back again. Phase shift errors between successive lines are therefore cancelled out and the wanted signal amplitude is increased when the two in phase, coincident, signals are recombined. NTSC is more spectrum efficient than PAL, giving more picture detail for a given bandwidth. This is because sophisticated comb filters in receivers are more effective with NTSC's 4-field color phase cadence compared to PAL's 8-field cadence. However, in the end, the larger channel width of most PAL systems and Europa still give their PAL systems the edge in transmitting more picture detail. In the CCAM television system, U and V are transmitted on alternate lines, using simple frequency modulation of two different color subcarriers. tests in some analog color CRT displays, starting in 1956, the brightness control signal, luminance, is fed to the cathode connections of the electron guns, and the color difference signals, chrominance signals, are fed to the control grid's connections. This simple CRT matrix mixing technique was replaced in later solid-state designs of signal processing with the original matrixing method used in the 1954 and 1955 color TV receivers. Synchronizing pulses added to the video signal at the end of every scan line and video frame ensure that the sweep oscillators in the receiver remain locked in step with the transmitted signal, so that the image can be reconstructed on the receiver screen. A sync separator circuit detects the sync voltage levels and sorts the pulses into horizontal and vertical sync. See section below, other technical information, for extra detail. The horizontal synchronization pulse, horizontal sync, or sync, separates the scan lines. The horizontal sync signal is a single short pulse which indicates the start of every line. The rest of the scan line follows, with a signal ranging from 0.3V, black, to 1V, white, until the next horizontal or vertical synchronization pulse. The format of the horizontal sync pulse varies. In the 525 line NTSC system it is a 4.85 microseconds long pulse at 0V. In the 625 line PAL system the pulse is 4.7 microseconds synchronization pulse at 0V. This is lower than the amplitude of any video signal, blacker than black, so it can be detected by the level sensitive sync stripper circuit of the receiver. Vertical synchronization, also called vertical sync or VSync, separates the video fields. In PAL and NTSC, the vertical sync pulse occurs within the vertical blanking interval. The vertical sync pulses are made by prolonging the length of sync pulses through almost the entire length of the scan line. The vertical sync signal is a series of much longer pulses, indicating the start of a new field. The sync pulses occupy the whole of line interval of a number of lines at the beginning and end of a scan. No picture information is transmitted during vertical retrace. The pulse sequence is designed to allow horizontal sync to continue during vertical retrace. It also indicates whether each field represents even or odd lines in interlaced systems, depending on whether it begins at the start of a horizontal line, or midway through. The format of such a signal in 525-line NTSC is: each pre- or post-equalizing pulse consists in half a scan line of black signal, 2 microseconds at 0V, followed by 30 microseconds at 0.3V. Each long sync pulse consists in an equalizing pulse with timings inverted, 30 microseconds at 0V, followed by 2 microseconds at 0.3V. In video production and computer graphics, changes to the image are often kept in step with the vertical synchronization pulse to avoid visible discontinuity of the image. Since the frame buffer of a computer graphics display imitates the dynamics of a cathode ray display, if it is updated with a new image while the image is being transmitted to the display shows a mishmash of both frames, producing a page-tearing artifact partway down the image. Vertical synchronization eliminates this by timing frame buffer fills to coincide with the vertical blanking interval, thus ensuring that only whole frames are seen on screen. Software such as video games and computer-aided design, CAD, packages often allow vertical synchronization as an option, because it delays the image update until the vertical blanking interval. This produces a small penalty in latency, because the program has to wait until the video controller has finished transmitting the image to the display before continuing. Triple buffering reduces this latency significantly. Two timing intervals are defined: the front porch between the end of displayed video and the start of the sync pulse, and the back porch after the sync pulse and before displayed video. These in the sync pulse itself are called the horizontal blanking, or retrace, interval and represent the time that the electron beam in the CRT is returning to the start of the next display line. The lack of precision timing components in early television receivers meant that the time-based circuits occasionally needed manual adjustment. If their free-run frequencies were too far from the actual line and field rates, the circuits would not be able to follow the incoming sync signals. Loss of horizontal synchronization usually resulted in an unwatchable picture. Loss of vertical synchronization would produce an image rolling up or down the screen. The adjustment took the form of horizontal hold and vertical hold controls, usually on the front panel along with other common controls. These adjusted the free-run frequencies of the corresponding time-based oscillators. By the early 1980s, the efficacy of the synchronization circuits, plus the inherent stability of the set's oscillators, had been improved to the point where these controls were no longer necessary. A typical analog monochrome television receiver is based around the block diagram shown below. Image synchronization is achieved by transmitting negative going pulses in a composite video signal of 1 volt amplitude. These are approximately 0.3 V below the black level. The horizontal sync signal is a single short pulse which indicates the start of every line. Two timing intervals are defined, the front porch between the end of displayed video and the start of the sync pulse, and the back porch after the sync pulse and before displayed video. These and the sync pulse itself are called the horizontal blanking, or retrace, interval and represent the time that the electron beam in the CRT is returning to the start of the next display line. The vertical sync signal is a series of much longer pulses, indicating the start of a new field. The sync pulses occupy the whole of line interval of a number of lines at the beginning and end of a scan. No picture information is transmitted during vertical retrace. The pulse sequence is designed to allow horizontal sync to continue during vertical retrace. It also indicates whether each field represents even or odd lines in interlaced systems, depending on whether it begins at the start of a horizontal line, or midway through. In the television receiver, a sync separator circuit detects the sync voltage levels and sorts the pulses into horizontal and vertical sync. Loss of horizontal synchronization usually resulted in an unwatchable picture. Loss of vertical synchronization would produce an image rolling up or down the screen. Counting sync pulses, a video line selector picks a selected line from a TV signal, used for teletext, on-screen displays, station identification logos as well as in the industry when cameras were used as a sensor. In an analog receiver with a CRT display, sync pulses are fed to horizontal and vertical time-based circuits, commonly called sweep circuits in the United States, each consisting of an oscillator and an amplifier. These generate modified sawtooth and parabola current waveforms to scan the electron beam in a linear way. The waveform shapes are necessary to make up for the distance variations from the electron beam source and the screen surface. The oscillators are designed to free run at frequencies very close to the field and line rates, but the sync pulses cause them to reset at the beginning of each scan line or field, resulting in the necessary synchronization of the beam sweep with the originating signal. The output waveforms from the time-based amplifiers are fed to the horizontal and vertical deflection coils wrapped around the CRT tube. These coils produce magnetic fields proportional to the changing current, and these deflect the electron beam across the screen. In the 1950s, the power for these circuits was derived directly from the mains supply. A simple circuit consisted of a series voltage dropper resistance and a rectifier valve, tube, or semiconductor diode. This avoided the cost of a large high-voltage mains supply, 50 or 60 Hz, transformer. This type of circuit was used for thermionic valve, vacuum tube, technology. It was inefficient and produced a lot of heat which led to premature failures in the circuitry. In the 1960s, semiconductor technology was introduced into time-based circuits. During the late 1960s in the UK, synchronous, with a scan line rate, power generation was introduced into solid-state receiver designs. These had very complex circuits in which faults were difficult to trace, but had very efficient use of power. In the early 1970s, AC mains, 50 or 60 Hz, and line timebase, 15,625 Hz, thyristor-based switching circuits were introduced. In the UK, use of the simple, 50 Hz, types of power circuits were discontinued. The reason for design changes arose from the electricity supply contamination problems arising from EMI, and supply loading issues due to energy being taken from only the positive half cycle of the mains supply waveform. Most of the receiver circuitry, at least in transistor or IC-based designs, operates from a comparatively low voltage DC power supply. However, the anode connection for a cathode ray tube requires a very high voltage, typically 10 to 30 kilovolts, for correct operation. This voltage is not directly produced by the main power supply circuitry. Instead, the receiver makes use of the circuitry used for horizontal scanning. Direct current, DC, is switched through the line output transformer, and alternating current, AC, is induced into the scan coils. At the end of each horizontal scan line, the magnetic field, which has built up in both transformer and scan coils by the current, is a source of latent electromagnetic energy. This stored collapsing magnetic field energy can be captured. The reverse flow, short duration, about 10% of the line scan time, Current from both line output transformer and the horizontal scan coil is discharged again into the primary winding of the flyback transformer by the use of a rectifier which blocks this negative reverse imp. A small value capacitor is connected across the scan switching device. This tunes the circuit inductances to resonate at a much higher frequency. This slows down, lengthens, the flyback time from the extremely rapid decay rate that would result if they were electrically isolated during these short period. One of the secondary windings on the flyback transformer then feeds this brief high voltage pulse to a Cockcroft-Walton generator design voltage multiplier. This produces the required EHT supply. A flyback converter is a power supply circuit operating on similar principles. A typical modern design incorporates the flyback transformer and rectifier circuitry into a single unit with a captive output lead, known as a diode split linear output transformer or an integrated high voltage transformer, IHVT, so that all high voltage parts are enclosed. Earlier designs used a separate line output transformer and a well-insulated high voltage multiplier unit. The high frequency, 15 kHz or so, of a horizontal scanning allows reasonably small components to be used. The first country to make a wholesale switch to digital over-the-air, terrestrial television, broadcasting was Luxembourg in 2006, followed later in 2006 by the Netherlands, in 2007 by Finland, Andorra, Sweden and Switzerland, in 2008 by Belgium, Flanders, and Germany, in 2009 by the United States, high power stations, southern Canada, the Isle of Man, Norway, and Denmark. In 2010, Belgium, Wallonia, Spain, Wales, Latvia, Estonia, the Channel Islands, San Marino, Croatia and Slovenia, in 2011 Israel, Austria, Monaco, Cyprus, Japan, excluding Miyagi, Iwate, and Fukushima prefectures, Malta and France, in 2012 the Czech Republic, Arab World, Taiwan, Portugal, Japan, including Miyagi, Iwate, and Fukushima prefectures, Serbia, Italy, Canada, Mauritius, the United Kingdom, the Republic of Ireland, Lithuania, Slovakia, Gibraltar, and South Korea. In 2013, the Republic of Macedonia, Poland, Bulgaria, Hungary, Australia, and New Zealand completed the transition. The United Kingdom made the transition to digital television between 2008 and 2012, with the exception of Barrow and Furness, which made the switchover in 2007. The first digital TV-only area in the United Kingdom was Ferryside in Carmarthenshire. The digital television transition in the United States for high-powered transmission was completed on June 12, 2009, the date that the Federal Communications Commission, FCC, set. Almost 2 million households could no longer watch television because they had not prepared for the transition. The switchover had been delayed by the DTV Delay Act. While the majority of the viewers of over-the-air broadcast television in the U.S. watch full power stations, which number about 1,800, there are three other categories of television stations in the U.S., low-power broadcasting stations, Class A stations, and television translator stations. They were given later deadlines. In broadcasting, whatever happens in the United States also influences southern Canada and northern Mexico because those areas are covered by television stations in the U.S. In Japan, the switch to digital began in northeastern Ishikawa Prefecture on July 24, 2010 and ended in 43 of the country's 47 prefectures, including the Ristoff Ishikawa, on July 24, 2011, but in Fukushima, Iwate, and Miyagi prefectures, the conversion was delayed to March 31, 2012, due to complications from the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and tsunami and its related nuclear accidents. In Canada, most of the larger cities turned off analogue broadcasts on August 31, 2011. China is scheduled to end analogue broadcasting between 2015 and 2018, due to the large size of the country. Brazil switched to digital television on December 2, 2007 in its major cities. It is now estimated that Brazil will end analogue broadcasting in 2023. In Malaysia, the Malaysian Communications and Multimedia Commission, MCMC, advertised for tender bids to be submitted in the third quarter of 2009 for the 470 through 742 MHz UHF allocation, to enable Malaysia's broadcast system to move into DTV. The new broadcast band allocation would result in Malaysia shaving to build an infrastructure for all broadcasters, using a single digital terrestrial transmission/television broadcast, DTTB, Channel. Large portions of Malaysia are covered by television broadcasts from Singapore, Thailand, Brunei, and Indonesia, from Borneo and Batam. In Singapore, digital television under DVB-T2 began on December 16, 2013. The switchover has been delayed many times until December 31, 2018. In the Philippines, the National Telecommunications Commission required all broadcasting companies to end analog broadcasting on December 31, 2015 at 11:59 p.m. due to delay of the release of the implementing rules and regulations for digital television broadcast. The target date was moved to 2020. Full digital broadcast is expected in 2021. In the Russian Federation, the RTRS full disabled analog broadcasting in June 3, 2019. Excluding capital city, Moscow, is a test region, where it happens 15 April same year. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.